beautiful morning and many thanks for joining us on our program on television this morning on ITV on our discussion segment, 2019 campaigns, 2019 election. And of course, when you talk about the election, the campaigns are already on across the country. And from major, from political parties, all the parties are major. So you find the politicians, the candidates, you know, already rolling their manifestos, party manifestos, and of course their own policy statements as the 2019 election approaches. But there are a group of people that must be carried along as far as we talk about this election. Who are the people? It is you out there, and of course me here too, you and I, the electorate. So the campaigns and the expectations of the electorate as the 2019 election approaches. Some 2-3 weeks ago, we saw President Muhammadu Buhari launching his campaign documents, statements, and of course tagged Next Level. And, you know, so many things about that manifesto. And we also saw the candidates of the PDP, former Vice President Atiku Abubakar, also launching his own campaign policy documents. And of course, about five-point agenda, you know, we had talked about in that campaign policy, you know, document. Above it all, he promised to give 3 million jobs annually if voted into power come 2019. These are some of the statements, you know, that characterizes that policy document. Well, this morning, 2019 campaigns and electorate expectation, we're so privileged to have Mr. Honorable, let me add that now, Osahan Obaraye. So you're welcome to this program this morning on ITV.
Thank you so much, my brother.
Yeah. And of course, we have my big brother friend, Barrister Ayodeji Ogedegbe. He's an esquire here in Benin. So you're welcome to this program this morning on ITV.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you.
We are also expecting Mr. Jermaine Imotuniye, who is also a politician. When he comes, he's going to join us so that he can also share his likes, his thoughts on some of the issues that we're going to be talking about here today. Gentlemen, you're welcome to this.
Thank you very much.
Now, as we set foundation for this discussion this morning, we've seen all the political parties and, of course, their manifestos rolling, you know, campaign and all that. Now, the greatest of it all are the electorates that expect so much from the candidates and their parties. Now, where do we really start talking from when we talk about these campaigns and the expectations of the electorate? Perhaps let me start with you, Osahan Obaraye.
Thank you so much, my brother. First of all, let me get something clear. I'm not an honorable.
Okay, yeah, Osahan Obaraye, Mr. Osahan. Are you scared?
Osahan Obaraye, Osahan Obaraye, we do
for you.
For me, yeah.
All right, thank you so much.
So, let me thank you for also inviting me. I think the greatest topic we are in for the very just now is 2019 elections. And without mindset words, I think it's really worth deliberating upon. But we cannot deliberate upon it without trying to shift the shaft from the sheet. The truth is that all political parties, the major ones for the very just now, have the same footballers, the same people in the forefront playing. No one of them in the forefront has really changed. But I think we can also use that one to say nothing good can come out of Egypt. So the truth must be told, my brother. We must be factor to ourselves. The present core of leadership we have, both in my party and in other parties, have failed us, have failed we, the electorate.
Is that your own opinion, or you got that from
a personal opinion?
Authority.
A personal opinion. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. The reason why I said so is that I think there is no week now I don't use approximately 7,000 to 10,000 to fuel my generator for me to have light. So to me, that is a failure on its own. So also, constantly, there are some issues. There are some pertinent issues that needed to be done by the present government that is not yet done.
Yeah.
But can we also zero that to say there is nothing good here to celebrate? To me, there is something to celebrate. There is something to make sure that The future is bright for Nigeria. But so also the electorate should not at this time, at this point in time, look at it to say we are not going to vote. No, this is the time you must vote better. If things have not really gone well for you, if you know the suffering you are in, it's not what you bargain for.
Yeah.
It's time for you to remobilize, re-strategize, and make sure that the future becomes better for you, your immediate family, your friends, and associates. So we must tell ourselves the truth. Nigeria, as we speak for the very just now, our leaders no longer think about us. What they think about is them and this present election. Mm. You see them, I said to you yesterday at the program Impact on Radio, I said, the loyalty you get from the present couple of leaders now is what you cannot see before now. You will get this loyalty and come March, April after they've been elected, either to ASSO, National Assembly, State House of Assembly, government houses, you will not also see them or hear from them again. They have that nature, they have that nurture that we've paid for it, we've done it, and you can no longer. So it's high time our people forget about taking TV 4000 on election day just to cast their vote and vote for whoever they know they can hold responsible to say, I voted you, Evans, where have you been?
Okay.
I voted you, Evans, you promised me this one, and this one is not there. If we don't try to strategize now, to vote for individuality, not just say because Evans works on ITV. So it's because Evans is my friend in ITV, it's going to be the best. No.
Okay, let me pause you so that we'll come to the barrister here. Now, just like what Usahan Barry has said, that perhaps the greatest problem that the electorates have now is their ability for them to really get a different thing from what they are used to. I mean, during the election period, during electioneering, process period, you hear the old campaign strategy language, you know, things that you hear over and over and again. So as we move towards this 2019 election, what do you think the electorate should really expect from the politicians?
Thank you, Evans. First of all, I'm Ayodeji Ogidimbi Esquire.
Okay.
You don't have that prefix barrister.
Okay,
it's a suffix.
Go ahead now.
Thank you once again. I think, like I said in Impact yesterday, we are still in the old shelf. Nothing has changed, like Osahon has said.
Mm.
We still have the same players. But I think out of two evils, you choose the lesser one.
Okay.
Presently, the state we are is nothing to write home about. We've never had it so bad in the history of this country, Nigeria. I think the electorate should be wiser this time. We should jettison that idea of mortgaging our 4 years to come with a party sum of 2,000 naira or 800 naira, 4 yards of print. Cloth for the women our politicians give. I said it in Impact program on Impact program yesterday that presently now call any politician on phone, they will pick your calls. But before now, call them, they will not pick. It's either they change their number, and if their number they didn't change it, once they know your number, you call them, they will not answer you.
Visit them because of their busy nature.
It's not busy nature because they don't need you at that time. They bought your vote for 4 years. It is now they are coming back again to renew another mandate. And that is why I'm saying the electorate should be wiser now. I came this morning here with a public transport. Very unusual. That is the effect of the economy on me. It is now cheaper for me to go by public transport than to go by my personal car. And that is one thing I have even conversed. If these politicians can cut down their expenses, the problem we are facing now will not be there. Now they will promise us light, they will promise us all sorts of things. But I tell you, the 4 wasted years we had with this present administration. Tell me one thing.
You cannot say 4 wasted years because there are some. There are.
That's
some.
My personal opinion.
Okay, except if you say so.
If I go further, tell me what new thing that was not in place before the inception of this administration that has been done. Is it light?
But like, if you want me to mention, I can.
No. Is it the rail transport that Jonathan started, or is it a Greek program that has been on and on? We've had it.
But Jonathan did not start the end power program.
What end power? In your own imagination, you go to school and graduate after 4 or 5 years or 7, depending on the course you read, and you are being given a job that is not commensurate with what you studied, it's not relevant to what you studied, and you are asked to do it. Is there job satisfaction? And what are they remunerated with? That is no job. It's just trying to buy the boy. And let me tell you, most of them are from a selected party.
Do you have evidence to prove that? Do you have evidence to prove that?
Okay. If that, we keep that aside.
We cannot make claims that we cannot.
Let us keep that aside. Mm. Is the job they are doing commensurate with what they expected by going to school to spend 4 or 5 years? That is not it. Let them create employment. Let the government make the environment conducive. Provide light, provide water, provide good roads. You see that job will be available everywhere. The artisans, the welders, for example, they run generators to weld. And you and I know that anything welded with generator is not as solid as that with NEPA light. We have this light. We've had an increase as usual, but the distribution is the problem. So let the electorate focus on those who can deliver, not on party basis.
Okay.
Now, let it be.
Also, Hambaraye, I don't know if you've noticed something from what people are saying presently, by these ongoing campaigns that have since started, right from when INEC lifted the ban. Now, you find a situation whereby the candidates, they seem to have their own programs, their own policy statements, different from the policy statements of the political party, that it's kind of fielded for specific positions. You hear candidates say, when I come in, I will do this, I will do that, against what the party that he's coming from or she's coming from is promising. And at the end of the day, it becomes a very big big task for the citizens, the electorate, to hold them accountable. Somehow, the electorate are even confused. Who are we believing now? Are we believing your party that said this? Or we are believing you as a candidate saying this? I wanted to comment on
Thank you so much, but I think I can comment on this as a politician. The truth is that the party has lost its grip on the candidates. The party itself has lost its grip on those they are sending. I said the reason.
I don't understand. How do you mean? Isn't it on the party that
I said lost
nominated?
Grip. It's just like
control.
A song in the house that dictates for the house. Maybe because he's a Yahoo person and he has money and the father is a bricklayer.
Are you saying that the political parties, they don't have mechanism to control their candidates?
They have, but presently as we speak, they've lost grip. Let me give you the reason why. The reason is because the party does not have resources itself to finance an individual. It's the person that is coming that is going to bring money. As party members, 90-80% of party members don't pay their monthly or annual contributions to that party itself. So you see the party struggling from the day of formation to the day that party wins election. How does the party get money to either pay for secretariat or also sponsor individual candidate? The party does not have. So what does it take? Is if I was Ahun Kobaye want to contest for an election in a given party, I have to use my friend like Ayodeji here and you to mobilize me for funds. unquote, as friends, to bring into the party to say, party, this is what I don't have. From your poster to the INEC issue, you are even the one the party will collect nomination form for you. You can see some getting 5 million, 8 million, 20 million, depending on your position you are going. That is a party itself. And at the end of the day, you no longer have control over the child you did not cater for from the cradle. It takes the grace of God to say, okay, let's do this. How can you say, okay, the party has started now with their manifesto? You will see the individual telling you the mobilization and everything depends on them. The party does not call to say, okay, we've sold from, we've done this. This is our annual budget. For our aspirants that are campaigning, this is 50 kobo, this is 5,000, this is 20,000. We use it as a party to support your political dream or political aspiration. The party does not do that. So you can say that it's best for that individual to quickly run his own personal race first, leaving the party manifesto aside. Because right from time immemorial, let's really go check it, my brother, we mustn't forget to ourselves. From party A to party Z, they have nearly all the same manifestos. Go and read it. Free education, good rules, free healthcare, this, all they have it. It's in, just go and check it. PDP, APC, AA, all of them. They copy from one. They just copy to say the what changes is the logo and the party itself.
So in this case, who should the electorate, who should they believe now? Who should they listen to?
They should listen to the individual itself, because that is the person wearing the shoe. There are some people the party even needs to win election. Let's cite the case of before the emergence of Buhari. APC as a needed somebody that had integrity, because Nigeria did that, and Buhari was corrupt. Let's only use the state as a case study. When the formation of ACN came, we needed somebody that can fly our ticket, and we went to meet Oshomole Lagos to come and help us fly, because then we needed a game changer. So you cannot bring in a game changer and dictate at that pace. What you need is like a divided house. You need somebody that can bring it together. So the electorate waiting for the party. Who is the party? Is it not we that are in the party? So if we decide, was there no ACN before? Is it not the same people that also metamorphosed to APC? Is it not the same people? When I watched the declaration, the campaign of Atiku Abubakar in Sokoto. If there were 20 men standing at the front of that campaign, 15 to 17 were immediate past APC APC members.
Just as we have in APC.
Yes, so you can see
in APC.
No, yes, you can. You also, you can see that the same 12 first 12 is the same people. So it's no longer party. What does the party has to say? No, what they are looking for, 80% of them, is either the former governor of Ekiti called the stomach infrastructure politician.
Okay, let me pause you so that I'll bring Ayodeji in. Now, Esquire Ayodeji. Now, with what we are looking at now, it appears that he just suggested that the electorate should listen to the candidates, their manifestos, their own programs, their own policies. Not necessarily the policies or the manifestos of the party. But in the beautiful old days, in the times of Zeke and all that, it was the party manifestos that the electorate listened to, that the electorate watched out for. And of course, we had, by some standard, we had more credible elections, credible candidates and all that. Now, this time now, it's kind of different. So with this situation, are we going to be having credible elections that give rise to credible candidates as we approach for this 2019 election?
Well, Evans, gone are the good old days. When this present administration of Buhari came in, the matrix was changed. And by the time he was sworn in and he read his broadcast, by the time 6-7 months elapsed, there were no ministers and all, and at the time the ministers were eventually formed and all. When you ask this, he will tell you he never said it. It was his party who made
such
promises.
So?
So that is why I am in total support with my brother Osahu, that it is the individual you are electing that you should face. The electorate should face them, not the party, because the party has no say. Because they neither sponsored or, it was the individual that determined how he sponsored this election. That brings to limelight this new policy.
Let's get something straight here. It is the parties, the political parties that bring forward and nominate aspirants to become
the highest bidder. To the highest bidder, let's put it that way.
Why do you say so?
Trying to monitor the spending limits of individual in this election, although I don't see that tax feasible, because you cannot account or you cannot monitor how I spend my money. I can pass my money through a friend or through others. Back to our discussion. I think the electorate have a lot more. The problem we are having in this part of the world is that we are docile. When these people are coming to meet us, they tell us, we'll give you this, we'll give you that. In the first place, what is the business of a legislator telling us you give us road, you give us water, you give us a house and that? That should be the business of the executive arm. From there, you should even know that they are not sincere. The business of the legislator is to make good laws. Look at even the laws for local government autonomy that was made by the National Assembly. Our own Edo State was part of those, the legislative arm that killed that bill, although it's been resurfacing again. What I should expect the people do is that when they come, a legislator or an aspirant going to the House of Assembly telling me I'll do this, I'll do that. Is that the business you are going to do? We have most of them in the House who for once have never stood up even to speak or to pass any, to move any motion or present any bill. Such person coming a second time, you allow him because he gives you 2,000 naira or 3,000 naira. I think we should be wiser at this time. We should challenge them, and we should even come into a social contract with them. Make them put this on paper, sign a contract with us, that if you go there, if for 6 months you did not perform, you leave the seat, and let another person, let there be a by-election into that vacant position.
Okay. All right, we also have in case if you're still watching, the program is still this morning on ITV, on independent television, and we are looking at the 2019 election one more time, looking at political campaigns and expectations of the electorate. We are still expecting, Jermaine Motunye, who are also invited for this topic today. So we still have some few minutes left here by my time in here, so I will still expect it. Now, Barrister Obaraye, let's, the 2019 election one more time, because it's something that we must talk about from now till then. The issue of INEC, let's digress a bit now. INEC trying to, set up modalities to monitor the expenses, the expenditure of political parties, and perhaps of candidates. Do you see it feasible?
You know, thank you so much, my brother. You just gave me a new title. I said the barrister. But maybe I will go back now to see if I can run a law program. The truth must be told. You know, one good thing that has distinguished me from my folks is that I find it very easy to say the truth. And he said, for you shall know the truth shall set you free. The truth is that INEC is still even independent. Not to talk of trying to do what they say.
Why are you saying so?
Yeah, INEC is not independent because they still have a father and a mother that gives decision to them when they want.
I don't understand. Okay. Can you clarify?
Yeah, I'm clarifying in this extent that INEC is not independent because they don't, on their own, you still have somebody that says this is your leader.
I don't understand.
You still have somebody that appoints the head of INEC.
Remove the head of INEC. Statutory.
Yes, statutory. That is why I said they are not independent. If it was we electing the head of INEC or them themselves electing the head of INEC, I would have said that. But that should not, we should not use that one to buy time. The truth is that even they are independent, they are not independent. But what they are saying they want to do, you just ask a question, is it feasible? No, it's not feasible. Yes, in my opinion, in the present day Nigeria. The reason is because, let's be factual to ourselves. If I like using examples, there are some people now that we do the money spending of that day that will be guided by the police officer. So many that the people that are going to do the money spending of that day, they have 1, 2, 3 police officers with gun guiding them. So you, my friend Evans, and I, that have one room, that sit in one room, our father telling us, if you go now, you know what you will see there. Are we the one now that is going to shout at that point to say, I need come and see, or police come and see? You are reporting to a police officer that is standing in the presence of whatever they are doing. So the truth is that INEC has a good story, but I don't see that story metamorphosing and those pregnant giving birth in 2019 election.
Okay, so what you're saying is that it's not feasible.
It's not feasible. It might be feasible in the future.
All right.
But for the very just now, it's not feasible.
Hi, Abeji, let me get your thoughts on this too.
No, it's a same thought, because I don't see how INEC can monitor. I have said it earlier. Individual or the party. Take the case of corruption, fight against corruption, for example. You see that it's one-sided. It's the opposition that have been moved into EFCC and ICPC offices.
But some say it is the opposition that has been in power. I mean, you cannot take somebody that has not been in power, take the person.
Was Amechi not in power? Was Fashola not in power?
But also, these are issues that have to do with facts.
What I'm saying, were they not governors? Are they not still in government?
Are there evidence to prove that they are corrupt?
How many committees were set up in River State?
Not setting committees. Now, what about
the UK regime over the corruption?
Did they come up with any evidence?
Well, I am not a politician. I always said this, I am a public servant, and I belong to a party called AGIP, any government in power.
What I'm trying to say, Evans,
is that the fight for corruption is not total. So I don't see the issue of INEC monitoring parties and individual as going to be a success.
Okay.
Full story, because they will certainly monitor the opposition and forget the ruling party. Like Osahon has said, someone appointed INEC. Someone is in control. We had elections where they even bring military to come and supervise. What is the role of military in a democratic setup?
Well, perhaps
Sambisa Forest and the militia and others are fighting civilian populace. They are used during election. The battalions and the numbers they send for elections are enough to fight a way Boko Haram.
Well, some say it is because of the do or die nature or do or die approach of our politicians towards our elections. So that's why you have.
You bring the military. What are
anyway, the mobile policemen? What have this story for another day? That will be a story for another day, so that we do not digress on that. You know, our discussion. Gentlemen, thank you so much, Osahon Barawe. And please extend the handshake to Ayodeji there. Well, when we return on the other side of this discussion this morning, we're going to be looking at INEC and how they really plan and to achieve the new one now, talking about trying to monitor expenses for from politicians, political parties for the 2019 elections. We are going to be looking at the limitations and the practicability or the feasibility of that new innovation that INEC is planning to do. Please stay tuned.
TMI, every opinion counts.
All right, thank you so much this morning on ITV there. Well, I did tell you that we are going to be discussing what seems to be a new innovation that the Independent National Electoral Commission is bringing in. most especially as it relates to this election, 2019 election. Yes, talking about monitoring the expenses of political parties, expenses of politicians during elections and all that. Now, various reactions, if you like, counter reactions have been made about it. Some say that it is not practicable. Some say there are limitations. Some say that it is a very good thing that INEC is trying to do. Well, discussing this morning, we have Mr. Larry Ogiva, who is a political analyst here in Edo State. Sir, you're welcome to, and also a politician too. You're welcome to this program this morning on ITV.
Good morning. Thank you for having me here.
Yeah, we also have my big brother friend, Mr. Nowita Egbotako, an author of many books, and of course, a human rights activist. He's not a politician, but he's a human rights activist, so he speaks for the people. Sir, you're welcome to this program this morning.
It's a pleasure to be here this morning.
All right. We also have a politician with us here, Mr. Victor Ogba. Sir, you're welcome to this program this morning on ITV. Yeah. Just yesterday, we understand that the Independent National Electoral Commission has said it will use devices to track campaign expenses of political parties for the 2019 general elections. The chairman of the commission, Professor Mahmoud Yakubu, who was represented by the commission's national commissioner, Professor Anthony Okoisi Simbine, stated this in a stakeholders roundtable while held in Abuja. The INEC boss warned incumbent elected public office holders against using state resources to fund campaigns. The commission, he said, has also reviewed and redesigned its campaign finance tracking and reporting forms that will be used by parties, candidates, and observers. Now, what we are simply saying is that there's a new innovation that INEC is going to be bringing in place, just like what I said earlier on, to track expenses of political parties for the 2019 election. Now, Larry Ogiva, what was your immediate response when you got that story?
Well, I see it as a part of our political and democratic development. We need it, most especially at this time in our political democratic setting. But is it doable? Yes, they will argue through the innovations and restructuring of the banking sector to BVN and so on and so forth, you can trace it. But we are Nigerians and we are part of the system. A situation where money, some of our people still don't put money in the banks. We don't put our some of us don't put money in the bank because we prefer, this is a country where we heard somebody, built a house, stopped it with foreign currencies and, put ACs and start freezing the money or cooling the money. So if such a man was not caught during the electoral period, how are you going to trace the money he's spending? Secondly, this is a system where the ruling party, in a bid to trample on the rights and the rights of the opposition party, comes up with very flimsy and unnecessary excuses, whereby you, in a bid to prepare the ground for political harassment after the election, you start saying things like this. We've seen it in this dispensation, where the ruling party or the EFCC start going after, the opposition party just to harass them, just to harass them and intimidate them. So if we are really serious in this country, INEC is really serious, what are the structures put on ground to checkmate these financial or money spending during the electoral period? What are the structures on ground? What are the facilities? What institutions are going to do this? Because you just say something just to confuse the electorate, just to tell the electorate or the Nigerians we are doing something about it, whereas you are doing something contrary to what you are saying. So INEC, as far as I know, as of today, INEC as of today is a part and parcel of this government in power.
No, I don't understand that.
Yeah, I don't want to go. Let's
clarify issues here. Is it part and parcel in the sense that this? I don't understand. Can you clarify that?
Well, in the studio, I don't want you people to.
No, you need to.
Okay. You see, take a look at what ANEC has been doing. I've had elections in Ekiti, elections in Osun. We had a by-elections in Kwara and some other states. You see how ANEC manipulates results. You see ANEC getting phone call during election, you know, reading out the results, collection of results, getting phone call from very powerful people and telling them declare results.
Do we have evidence to all this?
You see, this is why I said just now that I wouldn't want to go into such discussions, because if you say get the evidence, we saw it on television when the rec in Osun got a phone call and changed his decision. Is that not enough
the
evidence?
Decision that the
somebody won an election. The results was already collected. Normally, when results are cancelled, you don't.
Are you talking about the inconclusiveness of that Osun election?
There was result already declared. There was election. Democracy's majority wins the vote, whether it's by one vote or by, you know, half vote is already a majority. When you get, you know, the majority numbers, you won.
Yeah, but that decision was legal. It was a legal.
It was not, because those results that they now said was inconclusive was declared cancelled. You cannot use what is cancelled. You cannot use what you don't have. You cannot use what you don't have. If you say the results were cancelled, why would you not turn back and say because it was these results were cancelled because of that, on that ground we are cancelling this election? No.
Anyway,
The issue here is that ANEC itself is not serious.
Okay, that's your opinion.
Yes.
Now,
I just want to add something.
Yeah.
And thirdly, we are in a system where some religiously debased individuals now try to force or coerce politicians to bring out money.
Okay, let's hold it there because we're going to have plenty of time so that you can make your point one more time. Now, Vias out there, if you notice, he talked about INEC. Now, we ought to have a representative from INEC. As a matter of fact, yesterday I put a call through to Mr. Briggs, who is HOD, political parties monitoring unit. But he told me that he cannot come, that subsequently some of that time that he will come. So when that time comes, we're going to make sure that we'll bring him here so that he can share light on some of the issues, some of the allegations, if you like, now that seems to be emanating from our discussions this morning. Now, Nowuta Egbutako, I don't know what this innovation look like to you.
Well, the innovation on paper is fantastic, you know. It's a fantastic development because this is what is obtainable in other climes. You know, in Western democracies, you know, you don't spend money anyhow. The system is in place to monitor, to track how money is spent, how you get money to run elections and all that. I'm sure ANEC is trying to borrow a leaf from what is obtainable in developed democracy. So it's a fantastic development. But coming to a political society, a political environment where prebendalism is the way to go, where people are ready to kill each other to get nominations, where people are ready to manipulate the process to get elected. And after getting elected, they want to start squandering money without the consent of the people. So it will be difficult, you understand? But as a civil society person, what we encourage ANEC, because we want the best for our country, you know? And when people are saying that ANEC cannot do this, cannot do that, but what we should do is to keep ANEC on its toes. Yes, you are Independent Electoral Commission, you want to track an election, you want to track the funding, you want to track how money is being spent. Everybody should open. Every tentacle should be open and see how to go about it. Because if we're talking about the indices, the system, the process, what do I have the facility? Do they have the manpower? Do I have the capacity to monitor election in an environment like Nigeria? These are issues. But we know that during elections, a lot of things happens. Some people have access to helicopters. Some people, as you said, some people don't even put money in the banks. Some people can donate money to religious bodies in the name of funding the gospel. 2 million, 3 million, and all that. All these are processes that can, so it is going to be difficult, but we should encourage that neck. That's the point I want to make here.
Okay.
Because we know what is obtainable, people are ready to cut corners, people are ready to manipulate things in order to get results, not get elected, because election is a juicy thing. So we should encourage our neck. We should be able to ask our neck, which of your department, where is the capacity? I know people have talked about EFCC, that the EFCC may be partial, may be parochial, may not want to play the ball of the different people. That the EFCC may want to play the ball of the government in power, and I may want to play the ball of the government. But we as a people, I think we've been in the dark for so long. At this stage, that this is coming from my neck, we should encourage them to do the needful, to do the proper thing. So at the end of the day, at least if they don't have 100% sources, I think there's a way this can be monitored so that people will have a way to go.
Okay, positively now, in the country. Victor Ogba, if you listen to the two gentlemen that spoke and perhaps to listen to other people that have been talking about this new innovation, there seems to be a worry, a concern now, so to say, it looks like these are under mechanism, that INEC is going to use to kind of clamp down on the opposition party. Where do you think this suspicion is coming from?
Well, thank you, my brother. First of all, I want to state it clear here that it's not a new innovation. It has been part of the electoral. It's just that INEC is trying to resound it again. If you check the electoral act, I think section 80 or so, it was clear. It's clear we are what every candidate ought to spend. I think for the presidency it's about ₦1 billion, while for government about ₦200 million, and National Assembly 40, the State House Assembly 20 million, down up to local government like that. So what I'm trying to say is that it has been part of our constitution. It has been silent because truly, INEC really have what it takes to track the finances of these people? Because they know that it is not possible for them to do it. That is why it has been silent, not that it has not been there. Sometimes we talk about monitoring political parties during the primaries. Sometimes you discover that even INEC doesn't have the manpower to monitor party primaries. To talk about tracking the finances. So basically the fact is that we do not see this thing materializing come to reality. Why I'm saying this is that let me hope that INEC just want to see it. If not, the build up to election will start from primaries. This is not part of the election. In some of the allegations that we are hearing, both from the APC, that some money were being put into place for some money were spent for the primary, some money were given as bribe and whatever, if it comes to be true, it therefore means that people at the party primary, some of them have even spent more than what is allocated to them. Then let's look at the PDP. If the allegation of the PDP in Port Harcourt, the dollar bazaar, comes to true, it therefore means that they have people spend what they are supposed to spend in the entire election.
I can assure you that's not true.
I
was a part and parcel of that.
That is what I'm saying. I just mentioned both parties that the allegation we are hearing from both of them.
And I'm here to talk on PDP.
If it is true, then that means that both of them have people spend what they have spent above what they're supposed to spend in their main elections. So that now brings us to the issue if I then can. Now the electoral act is there. If you look at it straight down, it has its own problem. The electoral act only mentioned what the candidate ought to spend, but it did not mention what the party should spend. Of course, the party runs. So if the candidate has spent what he wants to spend, and tomorrow a big board is standing, and the party says it's the party that is responsible for the big board, how can you now hold the party responsible? Because the party, the electoral act did not tell us what the party should spend. And we know that it is the party that is responsible for the election, they have their role to play. So it's vice versa. So if you say you track the candidate successfully, then are you stopping the party from propagating their own function? So when you look at it, it has its own crisis. You know, when you look at it from both sides, you now see the difficulties on how to actualize this whole thing. Okay. So it is not fixable. If it is possible, then as we speak, PDP and APC should not spend any money again in the next election.
Okay.
And leave it for the rest of us, the NCP and other political parties, to spend in our because we have not even, I don't think we can even spend up to that before we win our election.
All right, gentlemen, just to stretch this discussion a bit further. Now, Victor Ogba talked about the Electoral Act, and as we speak now, the Electoral Act has been sent to the president four good times, and four good times he has rejected it. Now, it is still with the president anyway. Now, the fifth item that we have in the Electoral Act that National Assembly sent to the president is parties can no longer impose arbitrary nomination fees on political aspirants. The bill passed prescribes limits for each elective office as follows. 150,000 naira for ward councillorship aspirants in the FCT, 250,000 naira for an area council chairmanship aspirant in the FCT, and of course 500,000 naira for a House of Assembly aspirant, 1 million naira for a House of Representatives aspirant, and then 2 million naira for a senatorial aspirant, and of course we also have 5 million naira for a governorship aspirant and 10 million naira for a presidential aspirant. Now this is part of the act that is before the president for accent. Now it is not, well, the way it is now, it is not a law, but it was there before, except for the fact that they are trying to amend it. Now with all this now, do we see the possibility, because there's something that is in the law that needs attention by the president, and of course we have INEC now bringing it up that okay, that they really want to monitor these expenses. Now with all these scenarios, do we see INEC going further in all of this, Larry Ogiva?
You see, like I said, and I stand by what I'm saying, that INEC is on an agenda setting mode. They are not serious.
You cannot say they are not serious.
Though is a laudable, excuse me, I said that, that's what I want to clarify. Mm-hmm. Though it's a laudable objective, like my friend already said, it's also these things they are talking about is, has already been in the Electoral Act. Why is it now that they are now, it's a few months to election?
Why? Few months to the election,
yes.
Yeah.
Why? It's not even, I would say weeks. Why is it now that you are just waking up and now saying this? Because, like I said, they are on an agenda setting mode. The president or the ruling political party, if they are really serious, what is in this amended electoral act that is before the president that is not signable? What is wrong with what the National Assembly has prepared for the president to assent to, that they are now refusing to assent to?
Well, there are arguments, for example, the issue of sequence of the election. The
this
president
is what I'm
has
saying.
Said,
what are you afraid about? If a man, if you, what are you afraid about? If, for instance, you are very sure of yourself, you are a good man, you go to church, you pay your tithes, you do everything right, and they say you are going to die tomorrow. Of course, you should be proud and say, I will die tomorrow and I will go to heaven. But if you know you are a bad person, you have very, you know, bad ulterior motive and exterior motive, you have very bad intentions, you don't have good intentions towards your fellow man.
Now, are you trying to make excuse for why? Because we understand the arguments concerning the refusal.
I'm saying that even if they change the date of the elections, change it a million times, and the presidency knows that they have been doing the right thing, that Nigerians are happy with them, that Nigerians will vote en masse for them. Of course, nobody should be afraid. You go sign it and let us go to the polls. But because they have a hidden agenda, they are afraid that if we go to election with this, new electoral amendments, they know if we go like this and if this is passed into law, Nigerians will have the right and the privilege and the audacity to vote their conscience and vote well and vote them out of government. But because of this fear that if we do this, we will lose power. Of course, they are afraid. If they are afraid of losing power, they are afraid of losing, you know, the pace the privileges they are enjoying at the moment, the cabal in the presidency, are the people who are saying, no way. Let me tell you something. This new electoral act, in Benin language, there is a saying, that is, the laws you make against the poor, you will also affect the rich one day. So even this, if the president signs this law, this amended act into law, of course he may not gain, he may be voted out of power, but it will entrench our democracy, it will stabilize our political system for generations yet unborn. And this act is liable to change, you know, to corrections.
Once well, I also need to correct an impression here that the president signing the electoral act or not has nothing to do with the outcome of the election. So let's
of
get
course
that
it has
straight.
A lot to do. The president is afraid.
The other issues in the electoral act.
Excuse me.
Apart from the sequence of elections.
The other issues in the electoral act that makes the president afraid. So let us face reality.
Why you say the president is afraid? That's your own opinion.
If you say it's my opinion, it could be my opinion if I am just saying it. Why would the sitting president not sign what is explicit?
All right, Larry, let us not dwell so much on that.
So,
Larry, it's okay. Let us know because we have limitation of time. Now, Iputako, as we wrap up now, there's no doubt that some limitations have been raised. So how can INEC possibly, go against this limitation so as to achieve this objective?
Well, I see INEC, trying to live up to the expectations of Nigerians. But some politicians, just as he has said, he has been very clear about his own position. He has seen INEC as an addendum of the presidency. That's his opinion. But I want to talk for the civil society because that's what he even said, that whatever you are doing, you think of prosperity, think of tomorrow. But I think we should encourage INEC anyhow. We know the presidential candidate of PDP, Atiku Abubakar, has all the financial might.
How are you sure?
I'm coming.
Are you in his pocket?
I'm coming. Yes, because we know what happened at Port Harcourt. we know what is happening.
Were you there?
We know his antecedent. We as civil society people, we know people that have lifted the resources of this country. We know people who have got up to the level of impoverishment where we are. We know people who are supporting Atiku to come and take over the confidence. It's just unfortunate that when the country, the vibrant cerebral characters are not allowed to take themselves to the public to be elected. It's unfortunate that we are being faced with the situation of the devil and the deep blue sea. I'm not saying that Buhari is a fantastic candidate. I'm not saying Atiku is a fantastic candidate. But it's unfortunate that these two guys can never take out to El Dorado. That's the point of the matter.
Well, and we get to El Dorado.
We cannot get to El Dorado with Atiku.
Should be encouraged.
About my candidate.
Yeah. Right. INEC should be encouraged. Anyhow,
right, thank you.
Anywhere
out of time
to talk about electoral
provisions. How can INEC achieve this without all these limitations? Quickly.
Yeah, the truth is that for me, Nigerians have one lack of laws.
Certainly,
it is the implementation of these laws. In short, the few laws we have in our electoral act and our constitution, it is enough to govern this country and achieve what we want to achieve. The problem we have is the people. Let us get to a point where we begin to put Nigeria as everybody's project.
Okay. All right, thank you.
Put Nigeria as everybody's project, of course, we will succeed.
All right, thank you so much, Larry Ogiva. I know you are so loaded. Larry, please, can you get the handshake from me? Thank you so much. Please extend the handshake down.
It's a pleasure, sir. You have been very clear.
That's just the way it is here. We discuss, and of course, at the end of the day, we shake hands. Yeah. It shows that it is for this country to move forward. That's why we are here. Well, we'll take a short pause now so that all that segment will come your way. Thank you. Thank you. Well, this is where we call it a wrap today. Best thing you can do with your time is try as much as possible to be nice, to be good to people. I said it when I started this show that people that live with one form of disabilities, these are people that we should handle with utmost care because they have feelings too. They are humans just like us. Let's give them equal opportunities in life and you see that they will do great exploits. My name is Evan Zunuhuye, and many thanks to my crew members for all the way from 7 o'clock till about this time. And of course, tomorrow, Uyagbomofoibo is going to be here on the same program, this morning on RTV. Goodbye, and God bless you.